Hello my loves, welcome back to another video. I'm Ashley and today we have the mid-year freakout tag. I'm hoping I'm not too late to the game on this because I tend to wait until July so that we have the entirety of June to count towards this as well, because I'm like, it's not half of the year unless you count all of June. I'm really pedantic with it, and so every time I come to do it I feel like I'm late to the game because everyone's already been doing it. But here we are, we're doing it anyway. And I watched back last year's version of this because I didn't want to repeat myself, because I know I'm always like, oh, I don't usually do tags, but whatever. But from watching back last year's video, I now know that I'm 10 books behind myself in my reading challenge from last year, so I'm like, god damn it. I mean, ultimately it makes zero difference, and it's also very understandable considering how much of a different position I'm in from last year regarding university, working, where I live, everything like that. So completely understandable, but still, it's just an annoying competition against myself. But anyway, let's just sit down, have a bit of a chill, and do the mid-year freakout tag. So number one, with the question that I always feel like I'm awarding something to, we have the best book that you've read in 2021 so far. I always say that I am very picky when it comes to handing out 5 stars, and so I don't often have a lot of options for this when it comes around to doing this tag. But one that I have not stopped talking about is Master of Sorrows by Justin Cole. I read this one all the way back in January, and even though I have had other 5-star reads, they have been from books that I've kind of expected it from. Whereas with this one, I expected to enjoy it a lot, but I didn't expect it to be something that I would keep coming back to and keep recommending and keep talking about. And so I just had to give this one the title of best book of 2021 so far, because this one is a fantasy book which follows a guy called Anev who is training in a school of sorts so that he can rise in the ranks and become this kind of avatar, I think is what they're called. This means basically that they're trained to go out and find magical artifacts, any item that has a vague magical quality to it, and confiscate it, bring it back to the academy so that people can't use it, because in this world magic is seen as a bad thing. So in the very beginning of this book we see him training and working towards this competition to become one of these people. However, we also see him being stuck between two very different ideologies, because in his own standard personal life, ever since he was a young child, magic has actually helped him, and so he's been trained to think that magic is bad, while also believing that that's not necessarily the case. Now, we don't know too much about Anev's past, and as we start digging around in that, we start seeing lots of different little problems and mysteries that are coming to light. So this book just ended up being so much more than I thought it was. I love the mythology behind it. It's so intricate, and this is actually the start of what's going to be a very big series by the sounds of it. And it's also dubbed as a villain origin story. However, you wouldn't know it particularly from this one, because it's a villain origin story that will run the course of many books. So I just think it's absolutely fascinating. I have done an interview with Justin Cole, which I absolutely loved, so if you are interested in that, I'll leave a link to that down below as well. But yeah, I have just been shoving this into the hands of so many people, and I really want more people to end up loving it. So this one wins the title of best book so far this year. Then we have the best sequel you've read so far this year, and I think this is a very obvious choice for me. Although I do feel like I'm cheating a little bit, because this is a reread, because I read it towards the back end of 2020 and then reread it again. So this one is The Mask Falling by Samantha Shannon. This is the 4th book in the Bone Season series, my all-time favorite series. We've been waiting for this book for a very long time, and it was everything I wanted it to be when it came out. So if somehow you haven't heard me talking about the Bone Season series, this is a series in which clairvoyancy exists, but being clairvoyant is illegal. Our main character, Paige Mahoney, is actually a clairvoyant. She gets caught and the world opens up so much more from there. It takes such an interesting turn. I have actually done a video listing 50 reasons why you should read the series, because I just really want people to read the series more. So again, I'll leave a link to that down below if you need any more convincing. I've got you covered. But as I said, we were waiting for the sequel for a very long time, and I just adored it very, very much. For number 3, we have a new release that you haven't read yet, but you want to. I don't feel bad having not read this one yet, because it was released fairly recently, but this is definitely something that is on my radar so highly right now that I just had to talk about it, because this is Son of the Storm by Suyideri Zokunboa. This follows somebody called Danzo, who is a scholar set to achieve all of these great and wonderful things, but they don't want that. They are much more interested in finding out all of the mysteries, or rather all of the secrets hiding outside the city they live in, because nobody knows what's beyond those walls. Anybody who has traveled from outside the city has been sworn to secrecy, and so it's just this huge mystery of what lies out there. That is until they come come across somebody who has a type of magic which is apparently non-existent. And as they start learning more of this, they end up just on a crash course through secret history and all of these mysteries that I imagine propel our main character into a whole host of adventures. I love the idea of just not knowing what's outside the city and all of these secrets and a magic that's not meant to exist. Like, what does that mean? I'm so intrigued. I have to read this one as soon as possible. Number 4 is your most anticipated release for the second half of the year. And for this one, the first one that popped to mind was Beautiful Nightmares by KJ Sutton. This is the fourth book in the Fortuna Swan series, which I just have been loving. It's a self-published dark fantasy romance series and emphasis on the dark because, oh my god, trigger warnings galore. I'll leave those down below. But in the first book, we follow Fortuna Swan, who is the last of her kind being a nightmare, which means that she can touch somebody's skin and just sense all of their fears. She can manipulate them, she can take them away, she can use them in whatever way she wants. At the beginning of the book, her brother has been missing for quite a few years now, presumed dead, but she's never given up on finding him. And one day a fairy just pops up on her doorstep and claims that he knows exactly where her brother is, but he will only tell her if she agrees to marry him. Cue the intensely angsty romance, and this just proved to be something that is highly addictive. I have loved this series so far, and I am so eagerly waiting to see what happens in the fourth book, and also slightly terrified, but mostly eagerly waiting, kind of. I need to know that everyone's okay. This doesn't come out until December though, so got a little while to wait for that. For number 5, we have your biggest disappointment, and for this one, automatically the Starless Sea jumps to mind. Now, I actually expected this a little bit, which I am fully open about, and I really try to go into it with an open mind because I knew that if I went into it expecting to be disappointed, I likely would be, but it just hit on another level of disappointment that I really was not expecting. Again, I do actually have a full review of this because it was a Patreon pick, which means that it had a full video on my channel, and so that will explain my thoughts in depth, but the reason why this is so disappointing is not because of the book itself, although, I mean, it is, but the main reason why I was disappointed by this one is because I adore The Night Circus so much. Like, it's part of my identity at this point. That has been my favorite standalone book since 2016. Nothing has beat it since, and I don't know if anything will ever beat it, but I was really hoping I'd find another book like that from Erin Morgenstern, but that really wasn't the case at all. And it was really surprising because it's almost as if Erin Morgenstern showed the two different ways you could do whimsical magic, one of which really worked for me and one of which really didn't. So The Starless Sea was the one that didn't. It was a little bit too whimsical for me. It was nonsensical, is a word that I keep coming back to. It was whimsy for the sake of being random. I also just didn't gel with the writing style specifically in this because it was almost as if she was trying to be overly flowery. She was using far too many words than were needed. And I do actually give an example of this in the review video. So again, I go into it in much more depth there, but it's just, I was really sad to not enjoy this one. So here we are. I feel like my lighting got really harsh all of a sudden. Hang on. I mean, that really made no difference. Cool. On the complete opposite scale though, number 6 is your biggest surprise. And for this one, we have a very specific surprise because this is The Willful Princess and the Piebald Prince by Robin Hobb. It didn't surprise me that I enjoyed this book because it's Robin Hobb. She's one of my favorite authors. I knew this going into it. But what surprised me is that I loved this so incredibly much for a novella. Now, I'm not saying that because, like, oh, novellas are crap or anything like that. It's just, I don't typically gel with novellas as wholly as I would a full book. So I tend to rate them around 3 or 4 stars. They tend to be enjoyable, but because of the length of them, I find it really hard to engage enough with it to actually want to give it the whole 5 stars and to fall in love with it that quickly. This did that. This is the first time I've ever rated a novella so highly, and this truly felt like a whole experience because this kind of reads like a historical fairy tale-esque story from the world of the Farseer trilogy. This is set as a kind of prequel. It is more of a backstory history behind a legend, or I guess it is a kind of folktale that keeps coming up within the Farseer trilogy and even in the later series. This definitely helps with the series I'm currently reading, which is the Tournyman trilogy, because a lot of the attitudes of people are taken directly from the story. And so in this one, we essentially see the origin of the prejudices and the attitudes associated with the magic in the Farseer trilogy and just in this entire world that we have, the realm of the Elderlings. And so I knew that going into it, and I knew that I would find that interesting, but I think what really won this over for me was the fact that it did feel like folklore. It just perfectly combined this feeling of history and folkloric storytelling in a way that made it completely believable why this attitude stuck around within this world. And as well as that, I also made it an experience because I was listening to this, so I listened to the audiobook. The perspective that this is written from is the perspective of somebody who used to be the maid of the princess, who then as she gets older becomes a wet nurse and eventually just kind of lives within the castle without being particularly involved in anything, but she's just there as a kind of honorary part of the palace. And so she sees a lot of things, and she was involved more when she was younger, but she kind of takes a step back and she is allowed to just observe everything. And so that puts her in a perfect place for storytelling because she knows enough about the people there to be able to reflect on what they're doing and what they might be thinking and feeling. But she also has that level of detachment that presents itself as a narrational tone. And I really felt like I was sat on the floor in front of her, next to a fire while she's telling the story, almost like a child not quite believing that this is a real history, that these sort of things can happen in real life. It was a very specific vibe to this novella, and I just completely fell for it, absolutely adored it. And I just wasn't expecting it. I wasn't expecting that level of love for a story this short. So I feel like the amount I've just babbled about it says it all, so. Number 7 is your favorite new author, whether they are a new author to you or a debut author. It doesn't matter, either way it works. Now, as well as saying Justin Cole, because again, I crowned Master of Sorrows as the best book of the year so far, a different author came to mind for this. Not because I rated their book 5 stars, but it was very, very close to being so, and I think on reread it possibly could be. But this is an author who I think will become a legitimate favourite author once they've written more books, because I'm very pedantic about who I count as a favourite author and who I don't. I have to have read multiple books by them, so the fact that they only have one so far is the only reason why I'm not calling them a favourite author, but I know I will be very, very eager to read anything else they ever write because I just think this was incredible. And that is The Wolf and the Woodsman by Ava Reed. So Ava Reed is obviously the author. This is a fantasy book inspired by Hungarian history and Jewish mythology, which just felt, God, it really invoked that creeping sense of darkness in the background, but also magic, like very understated magic that just really worked. It felt folkloric. It felt like something you couldn't escape, like you were walking through a dark woodland and if you didn't move quick enough, you would just be like sucked in by all the branches and caught in the brambles. That's the sort of feeling this book had, and again, I fell for it completely. Again, the audiobook for this is incredible, and I just think that a lot of people would really love this book. I know that I certainly did, and I think it was very subtly done, which I think is why it worked so effectively, and so I just, again, adored this book. I do want to get a final copy because this is an ARC that was sent to me. I believe Ava Reed is working on a Dark Academia style book, which I just think would work so well with their writing style, so I am very excited and I have full faith that Ava Reed could very well become a favourite author of mine in the future, and so they get this title. Number 8 is Newest Fictional Crush, which just is never applicable. I know I could very easily just list like favourite love interest or whatever, but I just don't, like no one pops to mind. I don't do the whole fictional crushing thing, so no. Newest favourite character, however, I can give you somebody. It often takes me a little while to think of them, but this one just immediately popped to mind because this is Sorka from Heart of the Fae by Emma Hamm. This is a self-published fantasy romance book, which is a retelling of Beauty and the Beast. And I remember gushing about Sorka because her attitude, personality, the way that she would just bulldoze her way through everything, but also her humour or sarcasm or just way of approaching everything felt so relatable to me because she would kind of go along with it, but in a way where it's just like, well, I don't know what else to do. But she would also have this level of impatience and a little bit of a temper on her while also being this really healing soul that I could just see very, very clearly. Like, it was very distinct to me, her personality, and I loved reading about her and the Beast when they came together. The way that their personalities clashed but also worked and the angst that that created, and very specifically her personality shone when he was around and when they were having conversations together. I just loved seeing her as a character because she was such a peaceful soul while also being somewhat restless, which again sounds like a massive contradiction, but it just worked and it felt so natural and so authentic that I just loved reading about her. So Sokka from this book is probably one of the characters I've enjoyed reading about the most throughout this year so far. Number 10 is a book that made you cry. Now usually we don't have a contender for this because I don't cry too often. If you've been here in the past couple of months, you know. Oh God, this book. Wow. Why did you do this to me? This just... Need I say more? I cried a lot. We cried on a live show about this book. We just recalled the words that we read and cried on a live stream. Yep. Number 11, on the other hand, is a book that made you happy. And weirdly, this was really difficult to pick a book for because I don't tend to read happy books, you know? I tend to read fantasies that are a bit gritty and dark and complicated, and like, I don't sit down and think, oh my God, that was such a pure, like, wholesome book. No. We don't do that. One that did make me happy because I was just like, oh my God, I love reading this, is The Power of Hades. This again is a fantasy romance, and I think it's one of the first ones that I fully enjoyed and had like a quick instant happy moment from, I guess. Not because, again, it is still pretty dark. The romance side of it was just really, really enjoyable to read. The angst, the fact that it's a Greek myth retelling, just everything about the actual relationship in this was one of those that I was like, I love it. So as I said, this is a Greek myth retelling of Hades and Persephone, as you might have guessed from the title. This one is more of an urban fantasy because Persephone is living in New York. She is a gardener of some sort. I feel like she's got a very fancy, oh no, she works in a cafe, but she's working towards some kind of gardening job. She works with plants, basically, is what you needed to know there. And lo and behold, one day Zeus turns up, kidnaps her, takes her to the underworld, and forces her to take part in the Hades trials, which is a series of trials where people compete to become a Hades' wife. Now, she actually discovers that she already was Hades' wife, and so she just doesn't remember any of it. Everybody else there remembers this because they all know who she is, but none of them will tell her what happened or why she had her memories erased, and so she has to go through these trials, try and find out why she was married to this guy while also competing to become his wife again, and also figure out what she did so wrong that meant that her memories had to be erased and she was basically just exiled from the underworld. It's such a fun series, it really is. I still need to read the last book, but I know when I need a smile on my face, this will be the place I come. Number 12 is the most beautiful book you've hauled this year. Okay, these two are books from authors, both of which I've already mentioned in this video, but I just cannot with these covers because these are Fortuna Swan by KJ Sutton and Gilded Rose by Emma Hamm. Again, fantasy romance. I really feel like I haven't read that much fantasy romance this year, but apparently that's what's sticking with me for all of these questions. Fortuna Swan, this cover is probably one of my favorite covers ever. This is my favorite color scheme. I love green and pink together, but in very particular shades, and I feel like this cover just got it down perfectly. It's just absolutely beautiful. Look at that. I did read this last year, but I didn't get a physical copy until Kelsey sent them to me this year, and so I've just been fawning over it ever since. And then the same kind of goes for Emma Hamm. All of her covers are beautiful, but this one in particular I just adore because it looks like a fairy tale painting, which is exactly the vibe it's going for because, again, this is a Beauty and the Beast retelling. I haven't read this one yet because I do want to make my way through the series of hers that I have started, but I really feel like fantasy romance covers are doing well recently. Like, we stan. And then finally, we have number 13, which is, what books do you need to read by the end of the year? Now, I didn't really know what to go for this until I realized there's a few trilogies that I am very close to completing and would be very happy with myself if I did complete them. So I've picked a couple of them out. The first one being The Stone Sky by N.K. Jemisin. This is the third and final book in the Broken Earth series. I absolutely love the fifth season, not so much the second book, so I'm very intrigued to see which way this one goes. And the same kind of goes for the next one, actually, because this is The Hero of Ages by Brendan Sanderson, which is the third book in the Mistborn series. Again, I love The Final Empire, but I read that so long ago. I wouldn't be able to like review it right off the bat now, but I do remember that I really enjoyed it. I read The Will of Ascension not too long ago and it was fine, but I do want to see how the series finishes up, especially because everybody seems to have a very particular reaction to the ending and I'm just like, what happens? Very intrigued. So hopefully come the end of the year, I might be able to actually finish up some series because that is just my forever goal. I say it in so many videos, I need to continue series. Come on, Ashley, let's actually do it. But that is it for the mid-year book freakout tag. So the one classical tag of the year has been done and I feel very satisfied having done that. And hopefully you have enjoyed watching this video and just having a little chat about books. Let me know what your answers would be. Do feel free to just do it in the comments. But I would love to hear very specifically what the best book of 2021 has been for you so far. I want to hear all about your favourite books, so do let me know. But otherwise, I should let you get on with the rest of your day. So I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, then remember to leave a like and a comment something that you're here. If you're not subscribed already, then please consider doing so. Down in the description box, you'll find information to all the books I've just mentioned, all of my social media and other bookish stuff as well. So be sure to check that out if you haven't already. But for now, I hope you have a lovely day and I shall see you next time with a new video. Bye!